Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Lucretia McCulley. I'm head of scholarly communications in Boatwright Library. And on behalf of the faculty learning community, New Models in Disseminating Knowledge, I would like to welcome you and thank you for your attendance. We are very pleased to have Dr. Tressie McMillan Cottom at the University of Richmond this afternoon. Dr. Cottom is an assistant professor of sociology at Virginia Commonwealth University and faculty associate with Harvard University's Berkman Klein Center for Internet and Society. Her research on higher education, work, and technological change in the new economy has been supported by the Microsoft Research Network Social Media Collective, the Kresge Foundation, the American Educational Research Association, and the University of California Davis Center for Poverty Research. Her new book, Lower Ed, The Troubling Rise of For-Profit Colleges and the New Economy from the New Press, was published in February 2017. It is receiving notable attention in both the higher education and mainstream presses. Dr. Cottom's talk today will focus on digital sociologies and the challenges of open pedagogy and open educational resources. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Tressie McMillan Cottom.
Okay, that's how I think I sound in my head most of the time. That's nice. Hi, everybody. How are you? Thank you for having me. Thank you for that wonderful introduction and for making getting here as easy as was humanly possible, considering I was the human in question, Lucretia. So thank you very, very much. She picked up early on that I'm not very good at directions and said, "That's all right, I'll stand out front and wait for you." And I was like, "Yeah, that's pretty much what needs to happen." So thank you very much for that. And thank you for having me. The conversation today, this is how I hope this will go. I am open to adjusting as you guys see fit, but this is kind of what I had in mind. So first, I would like to take a little time to tell you about some of the work that we've been doing at VCU in the sociology department, because it is a lot of that work is shaped by my experiences and work on various questions about openness, whether it be open pedagogy, how do we work with students in open spaces, how do we understand educational spaces as democratic spaces, et cetera, but also the challenges I had as a new bureaucrat or a new higher education bureaucrat in implementing a program that had as its ethos that we want it to be open and critical. So that deals more with what did it mean to adopt OER resources, what were some of the challenges involved in that. So I think it helps a little bit if you know what the structure of that program is and what my approach was to it. And then I will talk about some of the challenges and what I am now calling, you know, opportunities for development as far as that goes. And then very, very happily we'll turn it over to Q&A for, I hope, what will be a conversation not just between you and myself, but amongst us all. And then I have been promised that there will be wine afterwards. So if that works for everyone, we'll get started. All right, I've got way more slides than I intend to show you, so please don't get nervous. The only reason I actually insisted at the last moment to do this, because I actually prefer usually not doing a slideshow, it's become one of those conventions, however, so as a social scientist, I'm obligated to do them when I go to conferences, but I'm not good at them. It's not my thing, it's not my jam, but this time I actually had a really good reason. There was something I wanted to show you. So the whole thing, I'm gonna skim through this actually quite quickly, because most of it we'll be talking about, but there was one thing I wanted to show you. So let's get started. First of all, I always think it helps to know why I'm here, why I'm the one who's thinking and talking about these things, and how I think and talk about them. So this is sort of the, the stuff I've done. This is some of the stuff I've done. All of these around these questions. So let me tell you how I think of the big story. So the first is a book that I co-edited with my colleagues Jesse Daniels and Karen Gregory. The third book, the one over in the far right, is the one that is forthcoming with my colleague Sandy Darity. The one in the middle is my manuscript. These things seem really disparate, I think, to people, but the reason why I put them up here like this is really not so you can all just kind of look at the covers of my books, but there really is for me a grand narrative to these things, which is this. Society shapes technology, and technology in turn shapes society. Right? And so the way that I have been understanding that and the way that I work through that is to understand how technology has shaped higher education and work, and how higher education and work in turn shape how we use and adapt to technologies. So the Digital Sociologies book was our way of sort of asking broadly, was there anything in particular that sociology could contribute to the questions about what is technology and what does it do to our society and vice versa? Believe it or not, I'm not sure if I have any sociologists in the room, but that's actually not a huge question in my discipline, which is stunning when I talk to internet researchers and et cetera. But we're really still getting together a sort of cohesive framework for thinking about how technology shapes societies and sociology. So this is a new book, and believe it or not, it's still one of the first ones to sort of think about that. In particular, we wanted to think about that as a critical question, as critical sociologists. And now that does mean something in particular that I think ties together all the other work, and then also I think describes my approach to how we were building the digital sociology program at VCU. So to be a critical sociologist is to ask a certain set of questions. It is not just to ask how technology shapes societies, and then societies in turn shapes technology. It is to assume that there is some system of stratification involved, that technology shapes society differently for different groups of people, with a different set of rewards and risks attached to how we engage that process, right? So if we think that race, class, and gender are meaningful categories, for a critical sociologist, we would think about how race, class, and gender, those meaningful categories that shape our social world, also inform what kind of technologies get adopted and adapted and diffuse and which do not. And when they do get adapted and when they do diffuse, what are the qualities of those technology platforms, et cetera? And then in turn, how do people in institutions like colleges and universities, or in jobs and workplaces and occupations, use those technologies differently, and how are those technologies used on them differently? Right? So that's actually a little different than just sort of the big macro question of how technology is used. We have a particular kind of focus in digital sociologies that extends throughout my book, which is throughout all of my work, which is this question that clearly, right, just from an observational level, we know that all groups don't have the same access to technologies. Not even talking about, at this point, I think, laid to rest issue about the digital divide. I hope so. But anyway, right, but we're not just talking about the actual physical access to technology, but we're talking about the more qualitative stuff, right? Like how technology can and cannot impact your life based on who you are. Right. So for me, those questions shaped my experiences of studying something like for-profit colleges, for example, in a pretty major way, because my argument was technology was shaping how we were working in these really interesting ways that meant poor people and disproportionately people of color were not able to go to higher education in the same way as we assumed people went to college. And instead, their options have been constrained by technology in some meaningful ways, making high-risk college educations much more likely for those students. All right, so that's the big story and why I'm the one talking about it. All right, so we've been doing this thing over at VCU for the last 2 years now. It's a master's program in digital sociology. This is from our homepage. Believe me, we have critically interrogated why the woman is digitized and cut up into slices of pieces. Trust me, we've been there. We're doing that work. We got it. All right. Here's what you need to know for the purposes of this conversation. So all that work that I just told you about, there was a reason why I think I ended up at VCU, and hopefully why VCU ended up bringing me on, which is that we shared this perspective about technology needing to be critically interrogated, and that sociologists had something in particular to offer to that critical interrogation. So when we're developing this program, when I came on board 2 years ago, there were a couple of things that we knew needed to happen, right? If we were the ones who were going to be offering it, we wanted the program to be critical, not just in the what we taught, but how we taught it. Right? It doesn't make a whole lot of sense to talk about how technologies are adapted unevenly and can reproduce inequalities if we then adopt those same technologies and reproduce inequalities in the classroom. Right? Basically, we wanted to live our theory. Right? It's a radical idea. Then the other thing that needed to happen is because this is a 100% online program, we were going to have to do that within the constraints of whatever that meant, and we needed to be figuring that out. Right? And as some of you know, the population that we tend to serve at VCU tends to be incredibly diverse. So in many ways, we also couldn't take for granted that our students would come to us with the same sort of skill sets and experiences of adapting to technologies, right? So we needed to know who our students were. We wanted the program to be as critically engaged as we hoped our questions were going to be, and we needed to do all of that online. All right. Yeah, ignorance helps a lot. We were quite ignorant of a lot of that process, and trust me, it helps a lot. Because I don't think that we would have taken it on had we known some of the challenges. So let's talk a little bit about that. So first of all, it helps to know, I'm sorry that that cut off and mismanaged. Okay, over there. All right, so what is digital sociology? Again, for us, it needs to be critical. A critical digital practice is one of the things that we're trying to encourage in our graduate students. Knowing how to apply digital data, but also to ask questions of where that data comes from and to use it ethically and morally. We had some pretty big ambitions, and the second one is the one that I'll focus on today. Could we practice what we preached? Was it possible to have an open, accessible, yet rigorous and critical online education program? Maybe. Maybe is our official answer for right now. So let's talk about that. All right, so again, this is a master's program, and I think that matters. We'll come back to that in a moment. So it's not an undergraduate program, although the plan is still for lots of the courses that we're offering at the graduate program to inform our undergraduate curriculum, both on campus and online. So it's a graduate program. The majority of our students right now, I think the demographics matter. The majority of our students are women from Virginia, D.C. We start to dip a little bit into North Carolina. Most of them are currently employed and plan to stay employed in their fields, in the occupational field that they're working in, but want to do something different, right? And most of them have some understanding that the way that data are being used in the daily course of how they do their work doesn't feel very satisfying for them, right? And they want to become better expert users of that data, but also so that they can ask different questions of it in their workplace and how it's being applied. Because for most of these people, they are working in occupations that they consider to be occupations that are working with or have impacts on vulnerable communities. So nonprofit organizations, media organizations, and government or NGOs, right? All right, so first let me tell you the good news, some things that we do think that worked. So when we start to try to develop this online program with the idea that the praxis needed to be as open as we understood the theory suggested it needed to be, if we wanted those two things to match, we immediately started to look around for, could we make this a program that used all open educational resources, right? This was our initial goal. That a student who came to VCU's online master's program in digital sociology should not have any additional material costs beyond tuition. Right, so we were adapting that from all of the OER playbooks type stuff, right? I think I know the US World Bank one because I've been working on the OER playbook with them. I know theirs has that ethos. The Virginia Community College System has that ethos, that the OER, the whole entire point is that for students should not have any additional costs beyond above and beyond tuition. Now, as somebody who studies higher education, this matters to me a lot because I know that a lot of the political machinations of how we're trying to keep costs down in the university focuses on tuition, while we increasingly shift the increased cost of going to college to things like fees, right? So I knew that it mattered for sort of leveling access to high quality higher education for us to think about these issues. We had great leadership on this issue. Our department chair, my colleagues, and my people at our administrators at the college level understood what we were trying to do, and because of that, encouraged us to work around some of the bureaucratic constraints of adopting OER materials. So one of those constraints being, there are still many pressing questions about how rigorous the quality is of these materials. That they vary, that there's a lot of variation, and that when these things are made open and easily accessible, we lost all of the symbols of legitimacy, right? About who was producing them and what had gone into producing them. So we might complain a lot about how difficult peer review is, and trust me, I do the same sort of amount of complaining, but as it turns out from the other side, what it saves you in the resources that you try to use as you try to vet the legitimacy of materials, is something that maybe is a cost that we have not counted, right? Because what we ended up having to do as a committee is sit around and spend hours as a committee determining which materials were rigorous enough to be used. Again, especially since we were talking about graduate level courses. It would have been an entirely different ballgame for undergraduate courses, right? Again, something that we'll look at here in a moment. I don't know any way to go about this process of being open and critical unless you have an extreme amount of trust with your colleagues. And I think this is something that we're losing a little bit in the OER conversation, that it is all about technology. we had to trust the people who were producing the materials. We had to have an open communication process across the courses that were being developed and taught. We had to trust our colleagues to have the same sort of praxis and approach to developing their courses, even as they expressed their academic freedom to develop them how they saw fit. There was an extreme amount of trust in this process. In many ways, when we were meeting regularly to talk about the curriculum, what we were really checking in with each other about was to make sure we still trusted each other to be making these decisions in our own spaces, right? I think one of the risk of it being sort of a wild, wild west of open access materials is that you have to sort of have a process for vetting it, and you can't do all of that yourself. So what has to happen is that when my colleague adopts some materials, I've got to trust her approach to adopting them when I either now build my course to be in conversation with hers, or even later to adopt some of the materials from her course, right? I have to trust whatever process she used to determine whether or not these materials were appropriate and rigorous. Again, almost all of this trying to supplant what peer review does in the traditional publishing process. And that took a lot of compromise on our part as well. So again, when none of the materials were perfect, there was a lot of compromise about how we would supplement that while still trying to hold to the ethos that our students should not have to buy a $200 textbook to participate in our courses. Because again, this is ultimately what we were going for. Understanding that as being foundational to us having a critical learning environment that focused on developing diverse learning models. Part of a diverse learning model for us was taking into account how seriously the material constraints were for students to participate in higher education and what kind of barriers things like textbooks and additional materials were throwing up in the process for them being successful. So I think for a lot of that work, the leadership, the trust, the compromise, us buying 100% into the process of trying to do it, here's some stuff that only kind of worked. All right. So on the one hand, we're a graduate program, and that was great because our students do a lot of primary reading, right, of primary source material, and we thought that was going to make this process easier. It makes it easier for research projects. As it turned out, it was far easier for us to find open and accessible data and data sources than it was for us to find open and open, rigorous, and accessible educational resources, right? So we still do not have an acceptable textbook for any of our online classes at the graduate level, right? So what we have essentially done is taken on the task of developing them amongst ourselves, right? Putting together course packs that basically supplant the role of a good theory textbook, for example. Still really isn't one. There was an issue of quality and rigor within the sociology text. So sociology, and some of this I think is about what sociology is as a discipline, and I want to talk about that for a moment. Because I think it also applies to humanities courses and sort of more critical interdisciplinary disciplines. So sociology is not like econ. We don't have a single disciplinary narrative and a single disciplinary course structure. You can take a macro econ here at UR, at VCU, at Duke, at Harvard, at Princeton, and you're probably gonna use that same textbook. I actually know it's by Greg Mankiw, his textbook. I think it's like been adopted like 90% of all macro econ courses across the country. Econ can do that. Econ can do that is because econ does not think about what its praxis is. That's not what economists do, right? In sociological terms, we could say they have strict internal cohesion, which is just one way of saying they don't think about the critiques to the discipline. Sociology has as part of its imperative, however, to think self-critically about what the discipline is and what comprises the discipline. So you actually find, is anybody here familiar with the Open Syllabus Project? So this is an online repository of syllabi from across the country. It's a wonderful data resource. So you see a remarkable amount of cohesion, for example, among the econ syllabi and something like that, and the sociology syllabi are all over the place. Right. This doesn't mean that the discipline is weak. This means we're doing what we're supposed to do, which is when you study a society, you're also studying all of its component parts, and each of those component parts has a method, a praxis, and a theoretical approach. And we also tend to teach both the dominant understanding within the discipline and then the counter arguments within the discipline. That's what it means to be a critical sociologist, by the way. So to study both the dominant ideologies and the dominant assumptions, and then to also study the responses to them. And it is in that critical sociology part where all the stuff that we tend to associate with what makes sociology matter lives. All of the study about race, class, gender, and sexuality is in the critical stuff, right? That's where all the variation is in texts and courses as well. So even if we did have a really good OER singular textbook like Econ has with the Mankiw text, it still would not be anywhere near enough to build not even a single course around, much less a sequence of courses. As it turned out, the areas within the discipline that had the least amount of resources in the OER ecosystem were the ones that make sociology what sociology is. Let's take a quick look. This is why I had the slideshow, by the way. All right. I could have done this from any. I just pulled one, right? So this is from open textbooks, looking at it by subject, as we see here. I'm only missing a couple at the bottom that just got cut off in the image, so there's not much more than this. So if you, just a quick scan of what these texts are, right? You've got a lot of textbooks for things like intro to sociology, again, mostly appropriate for an undergraduate level, by the way. So this is one of those survey course books. You know, this is what sociology is. There is one book about minority studies, and even the subtitle, this one, I love it. It's a brief sociological text, because they're like, I'm not even going there. Which, to be fair, that's because one book really cannot do that in sociology. But yeah, they were like, yeah, don't even try me. And then you've got one in social problems, right, which is where we think about issues of like class conflict or inequality is being taught. But if I wanted to be a critical sociologist and use OER materials, how was I going to do that? That was our first problem. And that was just if I was open at undergraduate level. At the graduate level, none of this was appropriate, right? So we couldn't teach the kind of sociology we wanted to teach using OER materials. And again, this is pretty much the same in all of the data, but I went through three of the biggies. Okay. And the resources that were available, there were almost none written from the perspective of minority groups, by the way. All right, so another issue I wanted to go through before I kind of bring this full circle. So the other thing I attempted to do is say, well, okay, so we know that in sociology we tend to study things like race, class, and gender, but it is true that we borrow a lot from other disciplines to teach that. So for example, in my sociology of race course, it is not uncommon for me to use texts from African American studies programs, Hispanic studies, Chicana studies, et cetera. So maybe where we should see those texts, and it makes sense, maybe they aren't listed under sociology, right? Maybe they're under AFAM studies, which is the example that we're going to use here today. So the first thing I try to do, which is something I'm borrowing from Sophia Noble and others who do these sort of reverse algorithmic studies of trying to figure out how algorithms deliver information to you, was I wanted to search the way I thought someone would search who didn't have any of my knowledge base, right? So I just plugged in an open textbook for African American studies. Actually, I said black studies, and this is what came up. All right, this actually looks pretty good. First of all, it's associated with the university. I know of Humboldt. It was at a .edu address, all the things that we tell students to do, right? I checked for all of those signs of legitimacy. All right, so I said, well, I'm gonna try one of these things. And the thing called Academic Earth sounded good, because it said it provided open courseware for a variety of courses in African American studies, right? That sounds pretty good. All right. So I clicked on that, and this is the page I come to. I just thought that was fascinating. I'll give you a moment with it. So the landing page for Academic Earth is actually a lead aggregator for for-profit colleges. If I was black and I was searching for black studies OER documents, the first thing they were going to give me were links to Capella University, which is one of the largest for-profit colleges in the country. So I love that. And you can see how it wants my information over here on the side. So this is what my dissertation data looked like, by the way. I just did this kind of stuff over and over again to see where it took me. So okay, then I had to kick in with what I knew because I wanted out of this loop. So I did know how to get out of the loop here on Academic Earth. I did not want to register for information about a for-profit college, although you could see how maybe students who do not know any differently would end up there, or faculty members who don't know any different, because there are lots of us too. So finally get to the search results at Academic Earth. There are about 90 results. 75 of them are from the same person. From the same person. who is obviously just sort of taken to the idea of developing courseware in African American studies, which is wonderful, but does not offer a whole lot for our purposes, right? It was almost impossible actually to find queer studies materials, gender studies, African American studies, Hispanic studies, or anything that I might think of as being related to the critical topics in sociology. It was almost impossible to find any OER materials for it. And certainly, again, none that have been produced by the communities themselves, which is one of the assets that we think of when we think of those materials being critical and important to sociology. So for example, African American scholars, especially maybe those at historically black colleges, producing OER materials on African American studies, right? It's almost non-existent. Well, we can think about some of the reasons why that might be. This is my sociology hat again, and it brings me full circle to, I think, some of the challenges that OER is going to have with sort of broad-based adoption. And that is this, especially in a field like sociology, where we rely on that type of, on those type of materials. Somebody has to produce OER documents. They actually don't fall from the sky. The fact that they are free for you to use does not mean that they were free to be produced. That's actually a distinction that has to be made. So forgive me if I'm starting with 101. But I actually have to make that distinction to lots of people, especially in the modern university these days, who get very excited about what this can do for students, but they don't realize faculty labor is still a thing. Right? And we can think about the faculty who are more inclined to have the free time and the resources and the support to develop OER materials. There's somebody like Gregory Mankiw, who I understand is working on an open access version of his all-dominant econ textbook. Right? It is less likely that your queer professors, your African American professors, your Hispanic professors, your women professors are going to have the time, the resources or support to do precisely the kind of work that you usually have hired them to do, but in the open environment. For a couple of reasons. For most of us, this kind of work does not count towards tenure and promotion. Right? It's almost entirely invisible at the university level. So while we have resources set up, they have filters set up to value adopting open access textbooks, they have almost no filter for adopting or identifying those people who produce them. Right? So really what has happened is that universities have become consumers of other universities' faculty and academic labor. And while that's going to shape when you move a class entirely to OER, if you don't pay attention to that, that means you're going to adopt everything about that system that we don't like. Everything about four or five universities shaping the entire discipline, academic discipline, and everything that they think is important being the only thing that is included in the formal curriculum. Right? So this was a problem for us in a critical digital sociology program, hopefully for obvious reasons. And I'd like to say that we've completely worked that out. We have not. So again, we are investing a lot of resources in developing our own materials, but in the interim, we had to do the thing that universities have had to do time and time again. We had to get a book. Right? So working with library staff, who helps a lot, to try to keep costs down, but it was impossible given the field of materials that were available and the constraints of what our discipline is and what the goal was of the department for us to be completely OER. I still have some hope that eventually maybe it would be possible, but not without institutional resources. I don't think that the right approach to this is that this is a cheaper way to do higher education. It is a better way, but it is not a cheaper way. And when we focus perhaps on trying to lower the institutional cost for producing this, we probably just end up producing more of this stuff. And that's where we are over in the digital sociology program and some of the things that I'm thinking about and working out. I like to end on a high note, but I don't really have one right now, except that the courses are going along at a very good clip, actually. We've got a hybrid now of open access materials. Again, that's far easier in our methods courses than it is in our sort of, I don't want to juxtapose that with critical thinking courses, but our more theory-driven courses. So it is much easier in methods. I think that is just owing to the fact that it's easier to move methodological texts online than it is to do theory texts. And that's something that we've seen true both in online courses. MOOCs have the same problem. Every online course has a problem. It is harder to teach sort of critical, self-reflexive coursework online than it is to do a methods course. So methods has actually been far easier. And in fact, there are more sociologies in that field doing that work and more social scientists. Theory has been very hard. And if you're a discipline that relies on theory, OER is going to be a challenge. That's what we've learned. right? But I think still a worthwhile one, if only because what it ultimately helps do for the students groups that I am particularly committed to is that it does open up higher educational access to them. It just doesn't do it at a cost that some universities are willing to bear. Yeah. And I will end there and open it up for questions. Anybody? Anybody? Bueller? Bueller? Okay. Hi, Molly. Thank you.
So if the resources are kind of being shaped only by the public university, where is the funding, where is that coming from?
Mm-hmm. My experience has been mostly with working with, and so this might skew my answer is what I'm going to tell you. So my experience has been mostly with working with the stuff that like they've been doing at Harvard, who was an early adopter, to be fair. Harvard, MIT were early adopters of doing this kind of work. They pour a lot of resources into it. So faculty leave to do it, research assistants to do it. They have an entire, not lab, but like a production team there at Harvard that helps do all the stuff like the graphics, translating things like images into the, you know, the right format for online is actually a challenge. It's not that those professors are better. Let me just be very clear about that. They are not. Usually what happens is if you express an interest at some of these universities like a Harvard or MIT that you're interested in doing this kind of work, the institution will provide you support to do it. They send a really great sharp team to help take your course lecture notes and et cetera and translate them into OER materials. And because of that, you know, and either most of the people who tend to be doing that work are already tenured, so they're not chasing sort of the tenure clock. But really a lot of it is just institutional support to do the stuff that we don't think about. Like, how are you going to take your, all of that data you have of slides of like demographic trends that go back 20, 30 years and translate that without just sort of scanning it and slapping it up online, which is not what we think OER materials are. It isn't just putting like your slides online, right? It's about creating sort of a cohesive product that can be adapted and remixed. Well, to do that, you've got to adhere to certain types of digital publishing guidelines and best practices, and very few traditional academics actually know how to do that or have the incentives to do it. So at places like Harvard and MIT and others, they have sort of in-house production teams that help them do that. And then those become distributed and adopted and picked up because, one, they're there and they tend to be some of the better quality ones, frankly. But again, not because the content started off better, but because they had a different level of skills to get them done. And now some of that might just be the tax that very well-to-do universities do need to be paying. Right? The fact is that if you can afford to subsidize that kind of work, some of those universities do need to be doing it so that schools like community colleges can adopt them. That's actually part of our argument, that why is a community college charged, have to pay such a significant tax to adopt expensive textbooks that they don't have sort of a hand in shaping and don't get sort of the same experience of using. So that may be fair, but my criticism of that is, well, it also means, however, that there are going to be some really interesting constraints on what kind of knowledge is out there, and we probably need to be aware of that. Yeah. I don't want us to turn all of our critical studies programs over to Harvard. I would like that not to happen.
Yes. How open is open?
How open is open? It depends. Are you talking courses or courseware? Are you talking textbooks?
Like you were talking about the, you know, problems and diversities like that.
Uh-huh. Oh, the courses.
Yeah.
No. They still have to be enrolled. No, it's a degree program. So they're still in an institutional layer. Yeah. Oh, so let's talk a little bit about that, though. So about some of the maybe the challenges that came up sort of more at the student level, for example. So these are things that we're actually still working through. So openness as far as openness of classroom or the classroom space being open and online. So initially, our idea was the student work should go through sort of a post peer review process, kind of like work being done at social archives and other sort of online repositories where you post your work and sort of the public sort of peer group peer reviews it, right? And that this would provide a really important learning feedback loop for the students. So almost all of their work was supposed to be in an e-online portfolio, et cetera, right? and should be posted to an online repository, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So that still happens. However, we have as a faculty come together, and I will be fair, that was mostly me leading on that to say, no, we still need, I'll take responsibility for this one. We needed, students still needed a buffer, right? As it turns out, learning hard stuff in public is hard. It is actually not fair to ask the students that they critically engage something that we ourselves have not figured out a safe answer to in public and expose them to that risk. So for example, how are we gonna teach something like the gender wage gap that has become this huge political issue, right? And you were gonna have a first year graduate student reckoning with that and that data in public for people to see them doing it. It was paralyzing for students. And frankly, as a professor, it was paralyzing for me too, right? How was I going to protect them? How was I gonna work with students who were dealing about issues? I have one student, for example, who's looking at the economic burden within non-gender conforming relationships. Well, how are they gonna do that in a very, again, politically contentious sort of environment to deal with the issue of queerness and co-parenting in this way that didn't expose them to risk, especially given what we know sort of the incentives are online to sort of find this sort of information and to build sort of outrage systems about it. The university owed them more of a safe space than that. So what we have moved to is, again, more of another hybrid model, which is that online classes no longer have, the discussion groups are not public, the content is public. But where the students are working out the ideas is not. And actually, if anybody ever wants to do that, you can go to our RAM pages for the VCU Sociology Department. You can see the professors' work. You can see our syllabi. You can see how we've set it up week by week. You can see us, but you cannot see the student engagement. Their e-portfolio is public, but the e-portfolio is the content that has gone through our internal peer review, which is basically their professors grading it, right? So you do see more of their polished work on the other end. So yeah, open now is maybe half or a quarter open. Yes?
Sort of follow up way. So 5 years ago, all the talk was about MOOCs, mm-hmm. massive open online.
I vaguely
classes.
Remember. Mm-hmm.
Now that's kind of faded. As you were developing this, did you talk about that as a model and why that wouldn't fit?
Mm-hmm.
I know one part of the answer is because you want to control over students, you want to be able to admit students.
That's right.
But they share a democratic ideal that mm-hmm. we should welcome everybody in, that mm-hmm. our expertise should be shared. So mm-hmm. how does this differ from a MOOC, and how did you think about this model as mm-hmm. distinct?
Yeah, so there are a couple things. So yes, I was involved in those conversations about MOOCs, et cetera, blah, blah, blah. There are a couple things. The first was we were not gonna be obsessed with scale. We couldn't and shouldn't be. We didn't know why scale was in and of itself a virtue. There really isn't. It is not inherently virtuous, I was about to say, other than money. And again, if we were gonna be a critical digital sociology program, it made absolutely no sense to admit more students than we could help. And so we push back against that idea hard and consistently at the university level, that we are not interested in scale. If we stay about where we are, which right now in our graduate program, an incoming class is about 19 or 20 students, that is just fine by us. We want it open in the sense of exposing the students to an open marketplace of ideas and exchange of ideas, but not open in the sense that it was about bringing in 5,000-10,000 students per class, especially if we couldn't serve that many, which, as it turns out, is a good thing, because you know what MOOCs relied on to make that possible? The automation of everything. Right, the routinization and automation of everything from the courses being highly structured. So everything a MOOC was supposed to be, which was open, free-flowing, accessible, was not that at all, because the only way you can serve anything at that scale is to be McDonald's. We know what McDonald's does. It makes a patty in the shape of a patty for every daggone thing it puts on a bun. That's how McDonald's becomes McDonald's. Well, we didn't want to do that with this process. And in fact, we couldn't come up with a single way that sociology could be taught that way, given the nature of the discipline. I actually do think there are other disciplines that might be slightly more possible for, but it was virtually impossible for sociology. However, some things that I did think that MOOCs kind of got right, and that maybe we don't pay enough of attention to in traditional universities, is I do think that adopting the technology that makes sense should make sense, and you should do it. And we should lower the barriers to professors being able to do so. So we are always in a good-natured conversation with our tech people about adopting the tool that works best for us, one that hasn't gone through the 18-layer step approval process of the university, of saying that, no, we need an exception to that. Like, how am I going to teach students how to do it, how to work with APIs, for example, if we can't use a data extraction tool because it hasn't been approved by the college university, and by the time we explain it to the college university, the tool won't be useful anymore by the time it was approved. So working around sort of the bureaucracy of how technology is now administered in university, we did borrow sort of that ethos from MOOCs, which was use what works and run with it and adapt and adjust when you need to later. Yeah. Oh, and the other thing that MOOCs could not do, and one of the reasons why MOOCs were not successful, MOOCs couldn't offer you a degree. I've been in the room with Daphne Kohler and those. They wish they could figure out to do what we do. You know why? Because that's where, not only where you make money, but it's when you matter. So if we were going to take in students who have the demographics of the students we take in, it actually matters to me that they can get a job. Right? I don't think that's crass. I think it matters if a working class, first generation female student from rural Virginia has a degree that can help her get an actual job. And a MOOC was never going to help her do that. And for us to be able to do that for her, we had to constrain some of those other excesses that were created by scale. She needs access to us, right? That's the transformative part of that process. And we couldn't do that for 10,000 of her, but we could do it for 20. So yeah.
What were some of the expectations or reactions of your students? Have you had kind of student assessments of the program? Mm-hmm. Kind of things that you learned from that? For example, switching to a textbook at some point later.
Yeah. Actually, you know, as I think we might assume sometimes. So yes, well, first of all, we do have I think it's fairly robust because I designed it, data collection tool for the student surveys, which we started at the beginning to get a baseline, and we're collecting them every year, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, all that stuff you're supposed to do. So, yes, we are doing that, and as well as the sort of typical sort of end of semester faculty feedback forms, right, that the university, the college does. So I have wondered, and we've laughed about this a little bit informally, my colleagues and I, about how much we're sometimes far out ahead of where our students are, but think that they are with us. Many of them were happy to go back to a traditional textbook because they understood it. Like, you know, it's the devil you know, for good, bad, or indifferent. They know how knowledge is structured in a book that way. And I think maybe you're in graduate school, you're doing this thing, and if any of us can remember your first semester or so of graduate school, you're already overwhelmed. And then what we were adding to it was a whole other another level of things that they needed to become competent in learning how to do. And I actually think there was a little bit of relief when we started to reintroduce some of the more familiar sounding things. So for example, we have been surprised by how much they actually want to get together and talk. We thought they wouldn't want to do any of that at all, but apparently they do. And that's fine, so we adapt and we do that. And while they were certainly more open to, again, there's something about open data that they understand a little better than the way some of the open textbooks were structured that just seemed to make more sense to them. This is how this kind of plays out. It is something as simple as this. It was being able to say, read chapters 1 through 18. And that correspond to page numbers. For whatever reason, that matters. And the fact that they could flip to the page, like, okay, who knew, right? Like, so for some of that, it has worked out. The students so far seem to be fairly satisfied. They hate the methods class, but everybody always does. They think it goes too fast. Everybody always does. But as far as like the other stuff, the stuff that we thought of as what was sort of new and innovative about structuring the program, they've adapted fairly well as the changes have gone on. Some of them, they've driven some of those changes. Yes?
Is it a synchronous or asynchronous or hybrid in classes you talk about? Mm-hmm.
Yes, it does. It's a variety. Some of it right now, based on what the content is. So the content drives a lot of it. Like, it is easier to do an asynchronous class again with methods, is what we're finding, than it is with theory. There's just no, we don't have it anyway. If somebody else has one, then please tell me about it. To teach theory, for example, send them off with a book, you know, of Merton, and then tell them to come back and tell me what was important in it was just not working for anybody. And so we needed to meet. So what we've ended up doing for most of those is, because I actually teach those courses, I'm going to tell you what happens. I have done a lot more, and I will link to this. I always do a post for my talks. I'll link to this on my website for you if you'd like to see how I had the sociological theory course set up. So you can see about halfway through what I call the course flows, when I started switching to doing a lot more video, because they wanted to hear me talk about it, right? And then we also started doing a lot more Google Hangouts. So the students wanted more synchronous class, and we switched to that. I do open office hours and Google Hangouts, and they can drop in and out and speak to me. So they can sort of ask the more specific stuff that they aren't comfortable doing in the group environment. And you can see those changes develop. By week three, when it became clear that we needed way more of that, then we started finding lots of ways. By week 12, it's an entirely different course than it was in week one. You can literally see the development, you know. Yes, Alicia.
I had a couple of questions related to your remarks about faculty labor.
Mm-hmm.
Faculty time, I think that's really important.
Mm-hmm.
And so I guess one would be, did you think about using library resources, mm-hmm. like journal articles and mm-hmm. other resources that are free to an enrollable student,
yes.
not free to everybody?
Right.
And if you did think about that, then what kind of aspect of time came into that, of mm-hmm. curating all of those?
Yeah.
And then my second question, I guess, is a little bit larger, is do you ever see a time in higher education where faculty would be rewarded?
Mm.
Yeah,
that's a great question. So I'll start with the easier one. Yes, we rely on our resource librarian a great deal, who just happens to also be a sociologist, so I think that helps a lot, by the way. And who shares I know that everybody doesn't have this benefit. She shared our like interest in this stuff. So she's like, yeah, let's go, let's see what we can figure out, right? So here's the thing. So it's a grad class, so there were always lots of, again, primary materials, so journal articles, right? Here's the part that you usually, however, use a textbook or some additional materials for. It is, how do you put those articles in conversation with each other, right? It's the learning the 100 years before you conversation about social theory that's gotten us to that journal article part. That's the part that I usually use, is what I call the backbone of the class, and then the journal articles are slotted into them. That's what I need, is sort of how we have traditionally used textbooks. And so journal articles cannot replace that. To a certain extent, things like review articles could. So, you know, in our discipline, I think most have these sort of like state of a sub-discipline site articles that come out every once in a while. So like, what's the state of literature on labor market discrimination? And it will cover like, you know, 30, 40 years of thought in the major citations. But again, that's not true for every sub area. There isn't a good review article for all of them. And there are just some things that students need, we think you need to know to be a participant in the discipline, right, that you couldn't get from journal articles. So what we found was, in the materials that we end up putting together in course packets, it's basically a lecture wrapped around the five the research articles. It's saying, this is why we consider this an important article. It was responding to this trend that had been happening in sociology up until then. This was the debate that came out of it, right? Again, that's what we're usually wrapping around it. And there's not a really good substitute for that kind of thing. Especially for the students, this matters also, I think, for like accessibility issues. For students who need to learn things, who have developed systems especially to deal perhaps with learning challenges, for example, and so have learned a system for how to deal with new information, they rely on having a book that helps them do that, for example. And taking that away created some anxiety in people because it was disrupting the way they learned how to learn. And now we might think of disrupting that as a good thing, to the extent that we usually want to teach our students new ways to engage materials. But if you have something like many of my students have had over my time teaching, but if you have a learning disability where you have learned a very specific note-taking strategy, and it relies on how information is organized in a general sort of textbook, when you take that away from them, the 15 years of experience they have learning how to navigate sort of a neurotypical world also goes with it. And so just using journal articles for that actually is not does not usually suffice as a really good replacement. And so do I see us moving towards a place? You know, here's the thing. The OER is considered possible and plausible and exciting to many of us because it will cut out the evil publishing complex. No, me, just me. That's fine. I'll take it. That's fine. No, I'll own that. That's just me. Okay, sure. Okay, and let's just say somebody like me believes that, right? That it's going to cut out the Elseviers of the world or whatever. Here's the thing about the way knowledge production is set up in the university. That, however, is what the university rewards. So if we want credit for it, probably what has to happen is a publisher needs to be involved in it. Well, if a publisher's involved in it, for many of us, what's exciting about the process will no longer be exciting because you'd have all of the infrastructure that comes with it. I think the most possible third way forward is for all of those tertiary, higher education entities that support things like research and conference going and everything else, is if they provided those kind of supports to non-elite universities to have the same type of resources to help develop those materials as elite universities have. I say that to say, because then what could be built on that is tenure could be built on participating in one of those, as opposed to it being attached to a publisher, right, a publication company. So I think that's a way forward. So for example, I care a lot about minority serving institutions, and I looked at lots of materials when I was preparing for this talk, trying to find a single historically black college or university in the country that had any kind of infrastructure to do OER, and I couldn't find any. Many of them were consumers and participating in using OER, but not in producing them. And while I probably know why that's the case, because their tenure requirements are as strict as ours, but they have a fraction of the resources usually to meet them. Well, a publisher can usually help assuage that, but maybe also if you can do a semester or a year's leave to produce those kinds of materials with something like a MacArthur-funded grant, something that the university could recognize as tenurable, it could open up access to a wider diversity of academics and institutions to participate without introducing the publishers back in. Yes.
Are there any disciplinary organizations that are doing that similar kind of thing, sort of providing space for people to do this work, mm-hmm. and then reward them in some way that an institution could say, well, you have this fellowship or whatever,
right,
through your, just you're talking about how Sociologies, mm-hmm. open education, OER materials will look different than
right.
economics.
Right.
So is there any sort of...
That's a great question. The only thing that I know that comes closest has tech does it for humanities-facing disciplines, and mostly driven by Kathy Davidson's extreme acumen and understanding how these things work. I mean, truly, Hashtag is kind of ahead of the curve on that. It provides just those kind of things. A colleague of mine just got one of the digital learning grants, I think, where they're going to do the summer institute to develop some digital materials, got the grant that will support her being able to go, and of course is at an institution that had no kind of support for doing that kind of thing. And it's something that our dean can recognize because this is an institution supported by a MacArthur grant and is being done at this university, right? I mean, we do still operate in that world. And so short of destroying all of that, we do have to find some ways around that. And Hashtag has done a wonderful job of that. And their materials do skew more towards humanities because all of the founding members were humanities scholars and they still tend to support that. Although they brought me on board, and I'm a social scientist, but maybe not a real one according to some people, but so something similar to that, and I think it makes sense for us to have one in social science, computer science, and health sciences, right? I think those are sort of the big sort of areas that have a different enough disciplinary bent, that have enough sub-disciplines under it to be robust, but have enough in common where it would probably make sense for them to have something like that. Fingers crossed. I know there are lots of incentives for us to do it in healthcare sciences and health sciences. This is already a very expensive type of education to provide. Certainly opening up OER materials might help. And they already have sort of the pipeline to funding agencies. It makes a lot of sense for them to do it. I'm not aware of that happening yet. If not, I will turn it back over to Lucretia. Okay.
So we talked a little bit about the labor involved in a course like this up to speed. We've also mentioned a couple of times that it's not quite clear that any of this would count for you for it. Like, mm-hmm. is this counted against your teaching load? As we see, you have senior faculty and administrators had conversations, started to adapt a different approach for tenure and promotions so that scholars can do this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. It was the only way I was going to do it. Not because I didn't care about it, because I'm a black woman and I'm in academia and I have to ask those types of questions. So, yes. So it was part of our initial conversations about whether or not I was going to participate in the program and how that would look. It could not just be service, and I think that's super important. When we relegate it to service, that means there are only certain people in the department who are going to do it, the same way that's true for every service commitment in a department. So no, it had to be part of the teaching requirement, and mine is. It's clearly articulated in my contract and in all of my colleagues' contracts. Almost all of that being led and created out of thin air because there was no model for it whatsoever. So this is what I ended up having to do to make that, to translate that for university. I actually went back to Kathy and said, do you have anything about what you would like this to look like in tenure? She had some language that helped. So we borrowed the language. I had the support of my department chair. It takes a really strong bureaucratic chair, I think, to pull off a lot of this, who knows how to position that to the college. And then it had to be written into the contract, which had to go through several layers of additional bureaucracy. But yes, we had to have that conversation, and we're continuing to have it as we bring on new faculty members to teach in this program. What does that look like for tenure track eligible faculty like myself as research faculty, as opposed to teaching faculty, as opposed to contingent faculty? We need, and we're having to rewrite that process every time we go through
what
it.
Other departments?
I don't know. Other departments aren't doing it, so I don't know yet. Yeah, I mean, not doing the level of sort of orienting faculty to this type of program.
I guess I'm asking too about like the school needs tenure promotion standards in order for this to work mm-hmm. at the college and university level, mm-hmm. not just a contract that says you can do it or your department mm-hmm. can do it. So is your chair pushing that conversation
yes.
with the school so that the new biologist can also?
Oh, well, no. Well, I mean, because that depends. The biology chair has to do that. Nobody's listening to the social scientists about how to tenure the biologist. I think that's at the chair level, usually between the chair, the tenure promotion committee at the college level, and then the dean usually make those determinations. So the chair is really critical here, actually, because you have to have somebody that the college thinks it knows what the prestige, the appropriate prestige levels of tenure eligible is for your discipline. They're not, again, we don't listen to these things cross-discipline. So it would need a person in each discipline doing what my chair is doing in sociology. Now, when that happens, or if those conversations are happening, the same language from our contracts and the same language could be applied across discipline. But we can't push for it for across every discipline at the college level.
So part of the labor here is enlisting administrators and senior faculty.
That's right. Or what I call radical bureaucrats. You do. Yeah. You need somebody who knows the bureaucracy well enough to know which levers to pull, but who has sort of ethical commitment to doing this type of work and knows how to pull it off. And I mean, if you know how to produce that kind of chair or senior academic, then you can probably make $1 million doing a training program. But seriously, it does take somebody. Mostly the bureaucratic tension seems to be, it needs to be somebody senior enough and well-regarded enough that they assuage any fears about this being less prestigious work, right? Somebody has to take that on. Now, the good news is once one person takes it on, I've not seen much resistance after that. It's the first conversation that seems to be the hardest.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like that was sort of the main point of getting you, having a chair. You mentioned getting your tech folks on board, right? And like, right.
Yeah.
Were there other pain points like that, institutionally speaking, that either not surprising or expected?
Yeah, you know what I found surprising? I did not know in the modern university that things like the promotions, marketing people have become so powerful.
Yeah.
I was going to say, did not know. So I think what has happened is that because of where digital stuff emerged from, the only people in the university at one time knew anything about it, maybe were in marketing, and so they just sort of ad hoc took on some of these responsibilities, and now they live there, and trying to wrestle them back and bring them back under the faculty governance has been a challenge. Yeah, I was not prepared for that. Like, the marketing people, do you know the marketing people? Don't meet your marketing people is all I'm saying. As a newbie, I had no idea. I went to that first meeting with like marketing people and was like, what? Yes, that was interesting. We can talk more about that after I'm getting drunk on the wine.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.